So again, good morning, everyone. I'm Fayth Parks, chair of the Committee on Psychology and AIDS, and I'm pleased to welcome you to COPA's symposium titled Past, Present, and Future of HIV/AIDS Science and Practice in Psychology. I'd like all the COPA members in the audience to either stand or raise their hand if they're here. Here we go. And I want everyone to please feel free to approach the members if you may pass them in the hall or in your path along the way to learn more about the committee's work. So additionally, I would like to extend a heartfelt thank you to our co-sponsors. As you can see, there's quite a list. Basically, most of the public interest committees. And we want to say that we could not have done this without you. You helped to make this event possible. Now, additionally, before we get into the morning's talk, I want to promote two other events. The first would be the Psychology and AIDS Leadership Awards, which will be this afternoon at 3 p.m. in the Marriott Marquis Treasury Room. That will be an opportunity for us to celebrate the work of two fine leaders in the field, and we would love for you to come and join us again to meet them and to congratulate them. And then tomorrow at 2 p.m., Saturday, tomorrow, there will be another symposium, special symposium, Why Psychology is Still Critical in the Science and Practice of Addressing HIV/AIDS. And that event is also sponsored by COPA, but will be presented in the Committee on Early Career Psychologists suite. We want to engage our early career psychologists in interest in the research and practice and science related to this work. So, that being said, let me dive into this morning's talk. So, in the past 30 plus years, significant strides have been made in reducing the spread of HIV/AIDS, and there have been important advances in treatment and care. Now, although effective treatments have been made, HIV a manageable chronic disease, clinical concerns such as co-occurring mental disorders, addiction, and health disparities necessitate the need for continued social and behavioral sciences research and intervention. Now, psychologists have contributed significantly to the integration of behavioral health into the medical care provided to people with HIV and AIDS. Continued advances in understanding conditions such as depression and anxiety, addiction, stigma reduction, and evidence-based behavior interventions require addressing the barriers and challenges that psychologists face in this current zeitgeist, which includes reduced federal funding for social and behavioral sciences. So COPA members thought about this context, and we decided to offer this symposium that brings together the outstanding work of psychologists to examine historical, current, and future issues related to HIV/AIDS science and practice in psychology. Numerous accomplishments will be highlighted here, such as the innovative approaches for integrating medical and behavioral health services and technology interventions to improve adherence and reduce addictive behaviors. In contrast, issues related to the sociopolitical aspects of gender and health will be contextualized to understand challenges faced by women living with HIV/AIDS domestically and globally. And finally, this panel will address the changing roles and influence of psychology as they relate to research and practice in HIV prevention and care. The current challenges and barriers psychologists are facing and proposed future roles for psychologists will also be addressed. So next, the symposium co-chair, Dr. Sherry Wang, will introduce the members of our distinguished panel.
Hello. I will now introduce each of our speakers and the titles of their presentation in the order in which they'll be presented. Our first presentation is entitled Informing the Future of Psychology as a Health Service Discipline, Clinical Lessons from the HIV Epidemic from Dr. Eugene W. Farber. He is a professor of psychiatry and behavioral sciences in the Emory University School of Medicine, where he serves as director of psychology internship training. Board certified in clinical psychology, Dr. Farber is the director of behavioral health services at the Grady Ponce de Leon Center, a community-based, university-affiliated, comprehensive HIV primary care center. For over 25 years, Dr. Farber has conducted clinical activities, teaching, training, and research focusing on the psychological aspects of HIV. Among his professional interests is the integration of behavioral health services in HIV primary care settings. Our second presentation is entitled A History of HIV/AIDS in Women, Shifting Narrative and a Structural Call to Arms. Dr. Ramani Durvasula is a professor of psychology at California State University, Los Angeles, where she has also served as PI of two NIH grants examining personality disorders, major psychopathology, and health behaviors in persons at risk for and living with HIV/AIDS. Her work in HIV has largely focused on neuropsychiatric aspects of HIV, as well as adherence and sexual risk. Dr. Durvasula has also served as chair of the APA Committee on Psychology and AIDS and is working with investigators at the University of Johannesburg to develop a prevention program targeting transition age girls in South Africa. Our third presentation is entitled POS for Health, Internet Intervention for HIV Positive Substance Users to Improve Antiretroviral Therapy Adherence and Addictive Behaviors. Dr. Karen Ingersoll is a clinical health psychologist and professor of psychiatry and neurobehavioral sciences at the University of Virginia School of Medicine. She conducts clinical research on two primary areas: improving the health of people living with HIV and reducing the risk of alcohol-exposed pregnancies. Most of her tested interventions include motivational interviewing or technology-based methods of intervention delivery. She is the author of over 60 peer-reviewed papers and co-author of two books. She has trained practitioners to use motivational interviewing for health behavior change for over two decades. She has led teams to conduct research on community health in Limpopo, South Africa for the past 4 years. Dr. Ingersoll's consulting practice focuses on integrating evidence-based practices into real-world community settings, including substance abuse treatment, community corrections, and healthcare. Our fourth presentation is entitled Looking Back and Looking Ahead: Roles for Psychologists in a World of Changing Epidemics and Policy. Dr. Richard Jenkins is a clinical community psychologist and a health scientist administrator at the National Institute of Drug Abuse. He oversees a portfolio of HIV prevention grants among key population groups, such as people who inject drugs, transgender people, gay men, and people engaged in transactional sex. He also is co-project scientist for a new initiative related to the rural opioid epidemic, co-founded by the National Institutes of Drug Abuse, the Centers for Disease Control, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, and the Appalachian Regional Commission. Dr. Jenkins' previous experiences cross government, including the Centers for Disease Control, the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, and the Department of Defense HIV Research Program. His own research has addressed social behavioral issues in HIV vaccine trials, behavioral and social epidemiology, and decision processes in HIV prevention community planning. Our fifth presenter was going to be Dr. Stephen Brady. Unfortunately, he's unable to present today due to a family matter. We will miss Dr. Brady's expertise, and we send our best wishes to him and his family. Last but not least, our discussant for the panel is Dr. Richard Wolitski. Dr. Richard Wolitski is the director of the Office of HIV/AIDS and Infectious Disease Policy in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. His office advises HHS, Health and Human Services leadership, coordinates and supports programs and policies on HIV, viral hepatitis, and other infectious diseases of national significance. He began his work in HIV as a volunteer HIV test counselor in 1985, spent a decade at Cal State Long Beach doing community-based HIV prevention research, and 20 years at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention focused on intervention research, program monitoring and evaluation, communications, and other areas. He is an author of more than 130 scientific publications and has co-edited 3 books. He has brought his experiences as a gay man living with HIV to all of his work. He earned his PhD in community psychology from Georgia State University and his master's degree in psychology from California State University, Long Beach. I now turn our attention to our first presenter, Dr. Eugene Farber.
First of all, I'd like to say it's a great honor to be a part of this very distinguished panel, and thank you for the invitation to be a part of this project. What I'm going to do today is basically share my personal experiences of doing work in integrated HIV/AIDS care settings over the last 25 years or so, and talk about how they relate not so much to the future of HIV care, but to the future of what psychology is thinking about in terms of its identity as a health service discipline. And so over the last several years, you've probably become increasingly familiar with the idea of psychology as a health service discipline, where the focus has shifted from a psychosocial focus to a more biopsychosocial focus. And looking at applications of psychology across the spectrum of health and illness, and not just mental health. And as I've heard the dialogue about this evolve over time, it struck me that in HIV care, we've actually been doing this for a very, very long time, and that what we have accomplished is something that hopefully the field as a whole could learn from and benefit from. And so that's the spirit of my talk today. So basically, as I said, there's been a shift from a biomedical or psychosocial model in psychology, but there's been a shift in the field starting in the late 1970s from a biomedical focus to a biopsychosocial focus, and psychology slowly moved in that direction. But the emphasis is really less on the focus on the disease and more a focus on the person who has the disease. And this has been a very important concept in HIV care throughout the history of the illness. So with HIV as a biopsychosocial illness, we're looking at the social determinants of health as well as psychosocial context of the individual. We're looking at psychological processes and then how these intersect with HIV as a biomedical illness. And as psychologists, of course, we focus more on the psychological aspects, and it turns out that there are high rates of comorbidities of mental health disorders in persons living with HIV. As high as 50% of people living with HIV have some sort of co-occurring mental health condition that needs to be addressed. And then in mental health populations, there's a high prevalence of HIV. So you have the study that I cite here actually describes the prevalence rate as 4 times that of the general population. But there are a lot of studies out there that actually show higher rates of prevalence of HIV in mental health populations. So there's clearly an intersection of mental health and HIV, and we've known that for a long time. So these mental health conditions can contribute to all kinds of complications in HIV care. Decreased access and retention to care, because people, if somebody's severely depressed, they may not have the mental energy to get themselves into care, keep themselves in care. Complications related to adherence, as well as disease progression that tends to occur more quickly, and worse health outcomes related to untreated mental health conditions or neuropsychiatric conditions like HIV dementia, less common these days, but we still sometimes see AIDS-related opportunistic infections that affect the central nervous system. So it's very important for us to address these, and in HIV care, we've been doing that for a very long time. Just to give you an example of a recent study looking at psychosocial and mental health factors that are part of what are referred to as syndemic processes in the HIV epidemic. And basically what this is illustrating is looking at psychosocial factors and risk for non-adherence to antiretroviral therapies. So if you have one or two of these, you're 4.1 times more likely to not be adherent to your antiretroviral medicines. 3 to 4 of these, 5 times, and greater than 5, 8.5 times more likely to be non-adherent. So this really drives home the point that psychosocial conditions and mental health conditions really are important to address in HIV care. So when I step back and think about what has the role been for behavioral health in general and psychology in particular across the HIV epidemic, there are sort of several epochs that I kind of made this up, so I'm just thinking about the history of it. And the first part of this was an emerging health crisis when the HIV epidemic first started to unfold. And it was essentially a public health emergency, and behavioral health specialists, including psychologists, jumped in and got involved in responding to the emergency. And it was really about crisis management and advocacy, emotional palliation, and grief work is a lot of what we did in our work in responding to the HIV epidemic in its early years. And then we sort of entered this period where it wasn't new anymore, but it was a disease that was still very poorly understood from a medical standpoint. It was wreaking havoc on particular groups of the population, and a lot of fear and stigma was emerging. And this was the era of the early medical management, where medicine was starting to get a handle on how to manage some of these opportunistic infections, but there were no real treatments, the antiretrovirals that were available. It was unclear whether or not they worked, and in fact, toward the end of this period, there were data emerging suggesting that they really weren't working as well as perhaps was thought a few years beforehand. And so here, we were focusing our behavioral health efforts on trying to keep people hopeful, even in the face of uncertainty, supporting their engagement in medical care because there were some treatments available for some of the opportunistic infections. And then managing the neuropsychiatric complications, which people were starting to be able to be managed a little bit longer. They were living a little bit longer, but there were all kinds of neuropsychiatric involvement, including dementias and opportunistic infections of the brain that really adversely affected quality of life. And so we were involved at that level. And then we had the era in the mid-1990s where we had the advent of combination therapies, or what had been called highly active antiretroviral therapies. And it was discovered that through a combination of disrupting the replication of HIV at different points in its life cycle, we were able to bring the virus under control. And that ushered in the era of HIV as a chronic illness, which is where we are today. I probably came into the HIV treatment world around the end of the early medical management phase. So it's pretty, that was a pretty difficult time, but then within a few years, it was a pretty exciting time. So the point of this slide is to illustrate that we've been involved in this for a very long time in terms of behavioral health specialists and psychology in particular. And so the rest of my talk is really going to be about, so what did we learn from this, and how does that inform psychology in general as a health service discipline as we start to define ourselves more and more in that way? So I'm going to talk about several opportunities. And the first one is about contributing to humanizing and contextualizing care through a combination of a whole person orientation, cultural responsiveness, and patient-centered, a focus on patient-centered relationships. All of these contributing to hopefully enhanced retention and care and health outcomes. So in terms of a whole person orientation, adapting the biopsychosocial model, but also integrating with that a cultural intersectionality perspective. Psychology has been slow to adopt cultural intersectionality as a concept in terms of thinking about the interface of culture and psychology. It's something that comes from feminist theory, particularly black feminist theory. It's slowly making its way into psychology, but a very important concept, and it's the idea that there are mutually constituted relations among social identities. So you look at the person as an individual based on their gender characteristics, their socioeconomic status, their race, ethnicity, their nationality, their religious spiritual beliefs. All of these things come together in a particular individual that is expressed in a very individualized way. And so thinking about a biopsychosocial model, but also injecting a cultural intersectionality perspective is a very powerful way to come up with an individualized whole person way of thinking about the person who's in front of you as a person living with HIV or beyond HIV, a person living with a medical condition or a person trying to stay healthy in primary care. And so an example of the first piece or the second piece is cultural responsiveness. And we have a lot to say as psychologists and behavioral health specialists in general about environment of care and what it should look like, what a culturally responsive environment of care should look like, so that you have staffing that reflects the diverse backgrounds of the people who are served. There's receptivity and respect for diverse ways of being. Providers are trained in culturally responsive modes of care and also ways to think of themselves as cultural beings. And that consumers of services have opportunities for a voice in how care is shaped and delivered. And this is something that I think the HIV world has done quite well, not just in clinical care, but across the spectrum of HIV work in general. In terms of clinical intervention, an intersectionality-based perspective on case formulation, clinical modalities that are very individualized, and then a focus on patient-provider collaboration in the care of the patient so that they're working as a team, which is very consistent with emerging patient-centered care models in medicine in general. So we've been doing this again for a long time, and there are a lot of lessons here that are applicable to psychology as a broader health service discipline in terms of cultural responsiveness. And then finally, we have expertise in evidence-based practices to promote patient-centered relationships. So I have a couple of examples up here. Patient-centered communication, there are certain characteristics that lend themselves to greater patient satisfaction with care and greater satisfaction with their community, with their communication with their medical providers. And then there on the right, research that distills some of the characteristics of a healing relationship that works. So when the provider is valuing, is thoughtful about their use of power, and is abiding in their relationship with their clients, that lends itself to a better relationship between the provider and the patient. And again, we're in a position to be at the forefront of helping our medical colleagues in accomplishing these sorts of things. So a second opportunity is contributing to behavioral health medical care integration approaches. This is a very big trend in healthcare in general. And again, we've been doing this for a very long time in HIV care. And it turns out that people living with serious mental illnesses, there's a health disparity whereby their lifespans are shorter than people in the general population. And some studies have suggested up to 25 years shorter. So quite striking health disparities with regard to lifespan. And primary care is the most common venue for mental health care. It doesn't occur in the mental health centers. The greatest volume of mental health care occurs in primary care settings. And there's evidence that integrated care improves outcomes and reductions in mental health service disparities. So what we've been doing in HIV care, again, has applications here. These are some of the advantages of integrated health service delivery. It facilitates holistic care, expedites care coordination, enhances service access, increases timeliness of behavioral health intervention, and also importantly normalizes behavioral health. One of the most striking aspects of the work I've been doing for the past 25 years or so in an integrated HIV primary care setting is how much greater, as strong as HIV stigma is, mental health stigma is even greater. And it can be a real challenge even being co-located in a HIV primary care clinic, getting people to come see us. So normalizing behavioral health is a really important aspect of this. This is sort of a reverse pyramid that integrated care, we've learned, is not an all or none proposition. So service independence is obviously parallel care, but when you get to care coordination, for instance, you can be a private practitioner who initiates contact with a medical provider group and provides coordinated care, even if you're not located in the same place. You open up lines of communication, you collaborate on the patients you take care of. So integrated care doesn't require that everything happen in one place. And I think, you know, there's a tendency to dichotomize that. And it's important for us to think creatively about how do we provide integrated care, because doing co-located or team-based care can be more challenging and more expensive, and you need the right setup for that. So we need to think broadly about integrated care. Service co-location simply means that you're offering your behavioral health services under the same roof, but not necessarily working alongside primary care providers. Transdisciplinary team care is providing the service in primary care clinics, where your patients are seeing the primary care provider and then may come down the hall and see you. And then point of care integration is really the most integrated, where a patient may come in for a visit and they're in one place and the team comes and sees them. They sort of rotate in and comes and touches base with them. So they may see a primary care provider, a mental health provider, a social worker, a nutritionist, all in one visit, and the team is actually conversing and dialoguing about that visit in real time. So that's the most pure form of integration. And we do a little bit of each in our care setting. So we're co-located, we have transdisciplinary care, we have care teams, and then we have this point of service integration. So the third and final opportunity I want to highlight is contributing expertise to interprofessional colleagues on behavioral aspects of care. And this involves assisting care teams with optimizing their retention and adherence strategies, consulting on patient-provider relationships, augmenting provider and medical systems behavioral management skills, and supporting provider-team relationships. I can't tell you how important this is to our medical provider teams, our social workers, our the various providers in our building that provide different types of care, how many times they come to us for counsel on all of these aspects of the work. It's really a striking thing, and I think an important lesson for the power of what we have to offer medical care providers. So this is an example, and I'm going to sort of conclude on this. This is an example of a four-point, you could call it a model or framework for consultation on management of patient-provider relationships. And it comes from work we did through the Office on AIDS on helping to develop a curriculum workshop for primary care providers in working with their patients living with HIV. And these 4 points, the relational alliance, collaborative focus, provider empathy, and consensus building in the patient-provider relationship. This, if you're familiar with the psychotherapy literature, this comes from the psychotherapy literature. These are some of the key ingredients of what makes psychotherapy relationships effective. And so we actually have a lot of research that can help us to help our medical provider colleagues in thinking about how they want to organize their relationships with their patients for better outcomes. And it really is, these are the key ingredients for patient-centered care. And they're very hungry for these kinds of models. And I find it very helpful when I'm talking to my colleagues to use these 4 points. They very much resonate with it, and they can apply it pretty easily. One of the biggest challenges they have is that they have high volumes of patients that they have to see very quickly. And I'm not just talking about in HIV settings, but in general medical settings. Medical providers have to see higher and higher volumes of patients, and so they don't have much time, and so how do they do this? And there is a way to do this even when you're working very quickly, and it's simply taking the time. It's how you do it, it's not how quickly you do it. But making sure that you're using these sorts of these qualities in the course of your communication with the patient, no matter how short it is. So it seems simple to us, but to them it's a revelation, believe me. It's quite striking. So I had an opportunity to write an article for the American Psychologist that appeared at the beginning of 2017 in a special issue on patient-centered medical homes and the role of psychology. And this is adapted from that, basically summarizing the roles of what we as psychologists can offer, not just as clinicians, but also as consultants and as administrators and as evaluators of health programs. So this is determined by your health service psychology competencies, depending on what they are, and we don't all have all of them. But depending on what they are, we are trained in to varying degrees in all of these areas. We usually think of our clinical service roles, but the purpose of this slide is to get you to think more broadly than that. What do we have to offer that medical systems that we may not think about? And I can tell you from experience that they are highly valued. They really do come to us all the time for counsel. So in conclusion, the lessons we've learned from HIV care that can be applied more broadly is that health service psychologists can contribute substantively to clinical service provision, administration, and evaluation in any medical setting. That behavioral health services shouldn't just focus on the treatment of mental health conditions, but also on the promotion of behavioral health wellness across the spectrum of health and disease. And that we have an instrumental role to play, both as direct service providers, but also in supporting our medical colleagues in enhancing the work that they do. And I'll just conclude with this comment from Maya Angelou. And thank you for your attention.
Hi, I'm Ramani Durvasula. Good morning and welcome. I'll be talking about HIV in women. First of all, it's such an honor to be speaking alongside two people who are mentors to me in the field, Jean and Karen, which is humbling and a bit anxiety provoking, but I'm going to do it. And to see colleagues like Cherie, who's worked with me when I was on the Committee on Psychology and AIDS. So when I had the opportunity to give this talk, I realized it had to be equal parts history lesson and sort of laying out a roadmap for policy. Because as psychology, we forget we are historians. And if we don't learn from our history, we are going to repeat it. And it would be downright tragic if we repeated some of the early issues that were raised in the history of women living with HIV, not only in the United States, but all over the world. So let's start from the top. This is half of people living with HIV. Our numbers in the United States are different. It doesn't affect women at the same rates as it affects men. But when we look at these as global numbers, this is just as much a women's epidemic. We also, though, have to look at this as a human rights issue, because it is. And this isn't just about individual health care. We as psychologists are often vulnerable to tunneling, to focusing on the individual above all else. If we do not elevate the discourse about women living with HIV to an issue of systems and structures, and more importantly, women's rights, we are just going to maintain this epidemic exactly where it's at and continue to magnify the impact it has not only on the lives of women, but their children and the communities around them. So what is this a story of? When we look at this story, because it's not only a history, it's a story, okay? And we're talking about narratives. So this is a story of delay and disparity. By the time we started doing research on women living with HIV, it was already a big problem. This is about women not getting healthcare services that are always tailored to their needs. It's about the story of the other. I was talking with a colleague and I was telling him really what the story of HIV and women became was a story of villains and vectors. Women did not get addressed in HIV research until the women were infecting men or the women were infecting their babies. The women themselves weren't interesting except as vectors of infection. That can't happen again. The issues women bring to the table who are living with HIV or at risk for HIV are issues that must be addressed and not merely how they affect other populations at risk. It becomes a morality tale. It's the story of this isn't me, this is a woman who does sex work. This is a woman who engages in injection drug use. Early on, this is a woman who's a hemophiliac. This isn't my story, it's all of our stories. Psychology is in a unique position to respond to preventing new infections and ensuring good, appropriate, and holistic treatment for the women who are living with HIV. So women as such became an afterthought. This is a story of human rights, something that all of us as psychologists, whether we know it or not, are key participants in ensuring that human rights are protected and promoted for all populations, but particularly for those who are vulnerable. This also raises a really dark specter around the politics of health and science. The way decision-making was engaged in the early history of women with HIV had very little to do with science and everything to do with politics. That's no way to make decisions about healthcare policy. And here we are in 2017, looking down that same abyss again. We have to be very careful, and all of us have to redouble our efforts in how we use our science to inform policy, especially for vulnerable groups. We'll learn that story today. It's also about dangers around mythologies. Marriage and monogamy are a great one. That myth was not only promulgated in the United States, but also abroad. When we were working in my lab with Latina women, almost every Latina woman in our research project was monogamous. All of them had HIV. So that myth went out the window really quickly, and it really forced us to look again at what risk meant in women. It's also a story of trauma and violence. Violence is the co-epidemic for HIV, especially in women. So we need to look at that, and we also have to look at the impact of trauma, which features so heavily in the stories of women who have HIV, as well as their ongoing stories. However, the story of HIV in women is also a story of remarkable, remarkable resilience. Anyone in this room who has worked with women living with HIV hears stories that are so extraordinarily strong and brave. It rallies all of us doing this work to keep pushing for another day. It's about caregiving, not just of their children, but of their mothers. This is caregiving on both sides. And so we're seeing lifelong trajectories of caregiving stories in women living with HIV. It's a story of hope because many things are getting better. It's about persistence and advocacy. The early HIV women's advocates in the 1980s and 90s were as brave as they came. They were told no 1,000 times for every yes they got. And finally, it's a story of collaboration. This is a story of psychologists coming together with social workers, attorneys, politicians, physicians, psychiatrists, and grassroots activists coming together in the kinds of social justice work all of us should be doing in psychology, not just people working with women living with HIV. We all know the numbers, okay? So women, the cases of AIDS kept climbing up till 96. Highly antiretroviral therapies came in, and while the number of incident cases of AIDS or stage 3 classification started to drop, they still remained a high percentage of the total, and that stayed constant because women are, everyone is living longer with HIV in the United States. In women, this is an epidemic that is very much clustered in the South and in New York, the DC corridor through there. These are two different stories of women, women who are living in rural settings with HIV and the access issues raised there, as well as women living in urban settings. The one thing many, if not most of these women have in common is that they're all living under very limited economic conditions and all of the additional burdens that come with that. We know that African American women are disproportionately impacted by this epidemic. African American women are 13% of the population, 61% of infected women. That's an incredible disparity. You can see how that number is so flipped for white women. So this is a crisis in the community of African American women. And we know also that this is the disease vector for women is largely heterosexual contact. While injection drug use still plays a role, this is largely through heterosexual transmission, which means that is where our prevention efforts need to focus, and it's a tough place to focus because it's the one place women are often stripped of a lot of control, all of those factors augmented by variables such as violence. In sub-Saharan Africa, though, the story is quite different. Look at ages 15 to 24 and look at those incidence rates. Look at how affected young women are with new rates of infection in sub-Saharan Africa, particularly in South Africa. I'm happy to say my colleagues here from the University of Johannesburg, with whom we're starting to do work specifically with that age group of 15 to 24 year olds, because they are at such high risk for incident infection. So what do we know about women? Like I said, we know that this is a global healthcare crisis, not only in women, but also in their children. So let's break this down as a history lesson and look at it as eras. The early years in the 1980s, where it was about denial, delay, and tremendous frustration in the people working with these women. We moved to the middle era in the 1990s. Now we're seeing more awareness, far more organized advocacy, and the beginning of large-scale funded studies through both governmental entities, global entities, and commercial entities. And finally, the current era, the 2000s and the 2010s and on, we're focusing on treatment, but we're focusing now far more in women on global disparities and structural dilemmas. We are not going to address HIV in women by handing out condoms. And that's what we also have to get to the core of. We have got to get creative. We've got to go back to basics. Think like psychologists, think like scientists, but also think a little bit like anthropologists so we can get to the core of this one. Women have been notoriously omitted from clinical trials in HIV. Although they represent 50% of those living with HIV, in a systematic review of trials conducted in 2016, you can see they were significantly underrepresented in research. And what we saw was that women actually had lower representation in NIH trials compared to trials funded by other sources. Publicly funded trials in general had the lowest levels of women participating. And we'll talk about that historical trend. So we still don't know empirically as much as we should about women living with HIV. So let's go back to the 1980s, because this is when I was actually in high school. And at the very end, if I have a minute, I will actually personally contextualize this, because preparing this talk, I spent all summer reading books and magazines from the 1980s on women and HIV. First of all, it took me back to high school. Two, it reminded me that magazines are indeed made of paper. And three, it really showed me the gulf in knowledge and in how little we understood and were even attempting to understand. When Jamie Gertz, a young affluent woman from New York City, contracted HIV through a very casual, almost like one-night stand relationship, all of a sudden, that was what catapulted HIV into our consciousness, despite the fact that it had been impacting women of color for years. It almost, in essence, we needed this to legitimize and make this epidemic relevant. Ronald Reagan paid almost no mind to HIV, let alone HIV in women. In 1988, a Cosmopolitan magazine story, well, you know, I don't know if most of you probably are not Cosmopolitan readers, but there's little, like, little sidebar headlines, and one of them said, "Reassuring news about AIDS, a doctor tells you why you may not be at risk." It's a magazine targeted at young, sexually active women. Some of the quotes: "There is almost no danger of contracting AIDS through ordinary sexual intercourse," which of course made me wonder what the heck is ordinary sexual intercourse. You can't get the full article anymore. This was a very hardworking research assistant who went and tried to find every quote we could get from the article. And it was impossible to transmit HIV in the missionary position. This kind of promulgation of bad knowledge went on and on and on, with Helen Gurley Brown, the editor of Cosmopolitan, standing behind her words, the words in this magazine of their so-called expert. So what was happening in the 1980s? It was very much the vilification of the other, the bad woman. It was either sex workers and injection drug users or unwitting victims, somebody who had hemophilia, so it was okay. And you saw racial disparities there. The people living with hemophilia were often white women. The women who were sex workers and injection drug users were often African American women. My favorite were the inclusion and exclusion criteria for clinical trials in women. No pregnant women and no non-pregnant women. I was like, not sure who's left. So, okay, that could explain why women weren't getting into trials. And NIH was actually rejecting women-centered grants. There was a book I read that had some of the notes from the pink sheets of one of the early grants submitted in New York by Anke Earhart and Zena Stein. And basically they're saying that, why do we really need to bother understanding cofactors of HIV in low-income ethnic minority women? They have so many other problems. Do we really need to understand this? And that's literally what was being communicated by these study sections then. But grassroots development was starting to happen. Slowly but surely, some very important HIV women-focused organizations were getting a voice. In the 1990s, we're seeing that the African American community is responding. A magazine like Essence has put a young woman on the cover. This is a woman who was affected by HIV, but was a face in their community that was important, that was meaningful to young women. AIDS is now the leading cause of death for African American women, ages 25 to 44, women who are at their peak, at their prime, about to break out into the world and were getting stopped. It took until then for there to be the first national conference focused on women and HIV. CDC finally expanded their surveillance definition to include gynecologic conditions that would now accurately classify more women who were likely all undercounted or uncounted in the 1980s. We see now it's becoming a heterosexually transmitted illness. The female condom is developed. The female condom has still not seen universal uptake. The unit price is still quite high. And in South Africa, we're seeing it really hasn't made the dent it could. Again, it's a female-centered method. We're starting to see federally funded trials. And now in 1996, while I was on postdoc, actually, was when we saw highly active antiretroviral therapy. And my postdoctoral research focused on some of those issues. So we jump to the 2000s. The face of HIV is now, it's every woman. It's a woman who's decided to become pregnant knowing she's HIV positive, knowing this could be managed. However, women now worldwide account for half of all HIV infections. The disparities in infection in the United States continue to grow, with African American women disproportionately represented. Vertical transmission, mother-to-child transmission, is now being well addressed in the United States and in many parts of the world. Microbicide trials have shown mixed utility, but again, a female-centered methodology. We're seeing a focus on global issues. And pre-exposure prophylaxis is also being expanded to be used with women, and particularly women in serodiscordant relationships, but we're still not seeing the consistent uptake in women that we are seeing in populations of gay men, particularly young gay men. Bronfenbrenner's methodology has been applied to HIV settings, particularly with women, to really account for all the systems around a woman. This is not about being in an intimate setting and putting on a condom. There's a lot of people and a lot of systems weighing on whether or not that condom goes on. So it becomes almost a specious intervention. And these kinds of models remind us that when we try to encourage condom use, there's about 100 other people in that bedroom, and they're not all cooperating, okay? Violence. We cannot talk about the history of HIV in women without also talking about violence. Again, we cannot isolate the conversation. For almost half of adolescent girls in some settings, their first sexual experience was coerced. Not only does that bring risk into that first sexual experience, but it often sets the tone for sexual decision making and their sexual life in the years thereafter. And young women who experience intimate partner violence are significantly more likely to acquire HIV than women who have not. As such, addressing violence becomes an HIV prevention intervention. Okay? So it expands, the definition expands. These are interconnected pandemics. We know both rape and intimate partner violence place women at risk. And we also have to look broadly. Women who are living in conflict zones are prone to chronic sexual violence and trauma, a theme we're seeing repeated throughout the world, putting younger and younger women at risk for HIV. We have to view conflict as a risk factor for HIV, similarly with human trafficking. Finally, for women, issues around stigma, shame, and discrimination are often more potently experienced, can lead to isolation from families, with women being put out from their families, often becoming residentially unstable, and then reliant on settings where they're more vulnerable to violence or sex work or other means by which to provide for their children or families, secondary to these final factors, again, differentially pronounced in women. When we look at prevention, woman-centered prevention, this has been a complex conversation. The research on female condoms has shown they work. What's difficult is availability. They're not available and they're not cheap. Microbicide trials have had mixed success, but again, in the quest for a woman-centered prevention tool, it's sort of all hands on deck. Pre-exposure prophylaxis shows tremendous promise. There's the evidence base currently shows that it works. However, women don't get into clinical trials, so we're still trying to figure out side effect issues and some questions that really need to be put forth when considering PrEP for women are, will providers offer it to women? A lot of providers don't even ask women if they're having sex, particularly older women. Will women know to ask? Will the women ask for PrEP? They often don't know, whereas it's a conversation in gay men. It's not a conversation in women. Cost is still an issue in many parts of the world, and condoms still get, you have to balance condoms in with PrEP. PrEP works best when condoms are also on board. And that ongoing lack of all female-centered, access to all female-centered methods affects, is impacted, I should say, by these cultural factors, stigma, as well as economics, and finally, denial. Mental health issues remain a huge issue, echoing what Jean said. When we look at HIV in women, we have to address mental health issues, many of which predated infection. So the stress of HIV is often exacerbating mental health issues. There's a lack of access. And what we see is that the greater the number of socially disadvantaged identities a woman has, the greater the mental health impact and the mental health sort of disability after diagnosis. One paper addressing client-generated recommendations is showing that women are specifically asking for integrated mental health care, focus on acceptance and solutions and problem solving, addressing stigma, support programs that involve peers, and integrating trauma-focused care. When you look at reports offered by the UNAIDS and UN Women, they're saying the top four reasons adolescent girls and young women are left behind are violence, lack of access not only to health, but also to education, and policies that lack teeth. They sound great on paper, but they're not giving deliverables. They're not actually being turned into, not converting it into something that's useful. We know that in sub-Saharan Africa, women are not even aware of their HIV status. Right there, the intervention becomes testing. Having women know their HIV status, increasing levels of knowledge, which are lacking in that region of the world, and although girls are sexually active, they are not using condoms. So the work we're doing in Johannesburg is actually going to be a very girl-driven kind of a curriculum that we're building with investigators who have been in the field for years there to really come up with meaningful solutions and not trying to push Western solutions that don't even work in the West, you know, in sub-Saharan Africa. I wrote a paper in 2015 on older women living with HIV. And apparently older women are women over 50, which I now officially take umbrage at. But that said, all of us women over 50, one of the biggest issues that came up in the work I was doing here is that women over 50 are not asked if they're having sex. So as such, even in primary care, that no longer becomes a place to have conversations about sex. Women over 50 do have sex, and many of them have been out of relationships for some time or are re-entering due to widowhood or divorce. And add to that other factors such as a greater likelihood of having fewer economic resources later than life, ongoing discrimination and racism, as well as ageism. And you have even greater not only vulnerabilities, but lack of likelihood of responsive health care for women over 50 who are living with HIV. This is a group of women where we're seeing some slight upticks in infection, and that should be something we should is eminently addressable. Women do have different burdens than gay men. And we often just say, well, if you have HIV, we're going to study everyone together. Again, that's a naive assumption. We know that women often have very different kinds of caregiving and child care responsibilities. They do, many women, since these are young women being infected, they want children. They want families. HIV should not rob them of that right. They should be supported in all of that. The expectations around sexuality. We tell women don't have sex, and then we sexualize everything around them. To be a young woman walking through those minefields is hard enough. And in other global settings where girls aren't even allowed to have conversations about sex, this is an even more complicated set of issues. And then we see issues around financial disparity, the much greater propensity of women to be victims of violence, particularly sexual violence, and as we spoke about before, familial rejection. This then becomes a story of advocacy and leadership. Women need advocates. Women need to get into leadership roles where they can address this. We must organize. We must build coalitions, and we must create collaborative spaces. Women have to be at the table, but they're still struggling to get seats at the table, even in the United States. And so that has to happen if we're going to have meaningful conversations. And there's so many barriers to participation. They don't have the resources. Many of the women are balancing multiple responsibilities, and there's not even very good transparent entry points. There's lots of competing agendas, and so even when these issues get to the table, you don't have appropriate stakeholders at the table. So how do we learn? Again, we only study history, ideally, to learn from it. We've got to study violence. We have to address violence. These have to be systemic approaches to violence, not only in the United States, but also in other around the world, and particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. We must be aware of the psychosocial stressors women have been facing. Since the beginning of the epidemic, there's a disproportionate number of women living with HIV who live in poverty. We have to address these economic burdens with models that are not punitive, but are rather collaborative. We have to address relational issues and relational negotiation, but then we also have to embed this in structures of education and awareness of intersectional discrimination. We cannot say, you have to change your sexual behavior, here's a condom, and have a nice day. We have to change the structures. If we don't change the structures, we are asking these women to fail, which is exactly what we did in the 1980s. We must, as psychologists who have the voices, who have the seats at the table, address these structural contexts and also address other health behaviors like medication adherence, diet, exercise, and other wellness behaviors. We have to address things like mental health services and social services in a consistent way. Not here they are once. These have to be wraparound methods that carry over time. We also have to focus, though, on the resiliencies, strength, and growth of these women. And finally, we have got to embed social justice and advocacy training into graduate, in fact, undergraduate training. This cannot be something we learn after the fact. It is not clear to me why we do not have a required undergraduate class in social justice and psychology. That should be built into every curriculum. If all of us were learning that way, we would all be well equipped, even if this isn't our area of expertise, to address issues of women living with HIV. We have to access the huge global structural barriers: literacy, education, skills training, employment, and economic access. We have to broaden up to other frameworks. We have to work on decolonizing the frameworks we have. They are very embedded in Western methodology, in Western traditions. We have to move to, for example, frameworks offered by transnational feminism, which are much more relativistic and recognize these structural barriers in a systematic way. We have to have informed consent, accurate information about sex. We also, though, if we're going to prevent HIV in women, we have to target men, because this is a disease that is being heterosexually transmitted. So if we have to make these conversations, we can't silo them. Talk to women, talk to men, talk to them together. And that is one way that we're going to move this ball down the court much more quickly, much more efficiently, much more mindfully. And we have got, again, once again, getting away, decolonizing our frameworks, and bring HIV-positive women to the table. So often we bring our services to them, fait accompli. They must be there from the jump. It is arrogant for us to assume otherwise. I cannot know what their day-to-day life is like unless I live with them, sit with them, walk with them, and talk to them. We've got to do that from the beginning when we're designing our grants and when we're designing our programs. And this has to be elevated to the level of international treaties and governmental support for programs that address violence against women and HIV. This came from the Council for Women's Global Leadership. This is not just about a biological vulnerability. This is about gender inequality. This is about social factors. This is about socioeconomic status. This is about access. If we're going to do this work, we create all the rest of that. Do I have one more minute? Okay, this is the story I wanted to share, because it's really quite extraordinary. And it's really targeted to a lot of the folks in training, graduate school, internship, postdoc. When I did I spent all summer reading this stuff, and it's quite an amazing literature. When I started doing this work, it was about 30 years ago, plus or minus, and I had naively, I took a job on Wall Street, and I lasted a day when I realized I was a socialist, and they're like, you can go, but they let me have 2 weeks. And in that 2 weeks, I used their computers late at night. It was the 80s, and we didn't have computers at home. And I applied to every research job at Columbia University I could find, like literally systematically sat there, put stamps on letters, and mailed them. And would you know someone bit? And they offered me a research assistant job because they knew someone who knew someone who knew someone. And I came in just bright and big brown eyes, and I'm going to do this. I was an Indian girl who didn't know much about sex. I'll tell you that now. And I got a fast education because I worked unwittingly on Anke Earhart and Zena Stein's research on HIV. So what happened was, as I'm reading all these, what they went through to get these early HIV grants, I was actually the one who got to run the protocols up and down the street on 168th Street in New York and saw how those early studies came together. To tell you, they were running on the most meager of budgets, and the kinds of advocacy conversations, I would just sit in the side of the room and say, what exactly is happening here? To read it all as a history lesson, and now to have the privilege to do this work. We talk about standing on the shoulders of giants. The giants aren't just the investigators. They are the women who have eloquently shared their stories with me. One woman shared with me on my postdoc who was living with HIV. She said, my life had been a nightmare. I got infected with HIV. And then she got connected to services, and she said, here's what's strange. This is going to be a really difficult path for me. But for the first time, I am connected to services. My story has meaning. I have strangely found meaning in the midst of this. And in the years that have followed, I've heard the stories of hundreds of women, both tragic and beautiful, who are living with HIV. All of this is a wake-up call that all of us who have these abilities and these research capacities to continue being this voice and never play this tape back again. If we know that a population is vulnerable, we need to start fighting for them early and bring all of our science and clinical care to bear. Thank you.
Let me just say, wow. So, as I was sitting listening to Jean and Ramani give this these very eloquent and passionate histories of our work in HIV and AIDS care and prevention, it just makes me want to run out of the room and get back to work. So I hope you are feeling as inspired as I am. My job now will be a little bit to give a different context to bring us into the present and possibly starting to look at the future of where are we going with some aspects of HIV care and treatment. So what I'm going to tell you about is a novel internet intervention. If you think about what technology has brought to psychology, we have a lot of new methods to share interventions with populations who may be at risk or in need of treatments that we could never reach before in the context of traditional face-to-face treatment visits in a counselor's office, a psychologist's office, or a Ryan White clinic. And so I'm just going to share one version of this, but what I know from working in mHealth, mobile health, as well as eHealth, internet-delivered interventions, is there's a whole new world of possibilities for outreach to vulnerable people, not just in the US, but across the world. So that's a little context. And what I'm going to specifically focus on today is an intervention that we originally developed given the context of the patients that I am currently working with, who are in rural Virginia. And yet, we're expanding even beyond that. So I'll tell you a little bit about that. Despite the advent of combination ARTs and really effective treatment that could extend life, and for many of my patients who are doing well, taking their antiretrovirals for 20 and 30 years now, they can expect to die from some other cause, right? It's no longer the epidemic it was, at least in those contexts where we have highly effective treatment and the populations that can access those. However, there are some people living with HIV, even in those kinds of settings with good resources, who are not consistently benefiting from these treatments. And so I want to expand what we're thinking about beyond antiretroviral adherence to care adherence and to thinking about all the steps that it takes somebody to actually get into care, stay into care, manage their care. There's a requirement sort of for a lot of self-advocacy in this process, which vulnerable populations often are not sort of prepared to do. And then to stay in care and maintain sort of health protective behaviors for a long period. And all that we know about changing behavior really focuses on the initial action phase of behavior change. And we know so much less about what it takes to maintain behavior change over the long period. So there are a lot of gaps still, even in the context of really solid treatments available. So they're not still consistently taking their ARTs. And beyond that, they're not all improving other lifestyle habits that affect their health and speak to some of the contexts that both Jean and Ramani have given us this morning. Now, my career has been sort of working at the intersection of addiction and health, and so some of my favorite people are substance users. And what we know about them is they are at higher risks for non-adherence and for falling out of care when they're HIV positive. And there are a lot of reasons for that, which some have been already contextualized. But one part that's an important thing to consider when we're thinking about the use of technology as a potential delivery system for some of our interventions or treatments is that most self-care of all chronic illness occurs at home. And yet most interventions and treatments are designed to be delivered at our convenience, at a clinic, at our offices. So I'm really interested in getting over that and thinking about how can we reach people where they are with interventions that reach them maybe just in time at the moment where something bad could happen to try to help them in the moment. So care generally is inconvenient. For rural patients especially requires travel, which often means they have to beg, borrow, or steal a ride from someone who has a vehicle for a couple hours, potentially. And it's not available all the time. And sometimes folks are struggling and thinking about an issue like HIV that they're dealing with in the middle of the night when they can't see their psychologist, typically. So there's some room for interactive programs like the one I'm going to describe, delivered over the internet, that makes these barriers less. Now, you could say, oh, wait a minute, what about the digital divide? And we heard about this a lot 10, 15 years ago. And luckily, there's a lot of evidence now that this digital divide is closing. That's not to say that everyone has a smartphone or everyone has an iPad or some kind of tablet or computer access with consistent Wi-Fi. Certainly, even people who could afford those things who live in mountainous rural Virginia sometimes cannot get an internet signal. But this is, fortunately, a divide that's closing rapidly, and it's now much more common for all of our patients in our Ryan White clinic, living, you know, 400% below the poverty level, still have a smartphone of some sort. So there's some space to use technology to address some of these systematic problems. So I'm going to now get a little bit more narrow, move out of that context, and tell you a little bit more about a traditional randomized clinical trial and intervention development. I'm going to try to stick with the idea of having a broader context, but it'll be a little bit in the weeds. So our goal was we wanted to develop an internet-based or internet-deliverable intervention. We had done our homework, done our formative work with our patients in our clinic, who wanted something that was more convenient. We're lucky to have Ryan White funding that allows us to have psychologists and psychiatrists and social workers and community health workers and medical case managers in our clinic. And yet, we have a full slate of patients scheduled, and there are a lot of no-shows for some of the barriers to access that I talked about a moment ago. And so we wanted to talk with our patients about what do they want. And they really want technology. We published a paper a couple of years ago showing that access was actually much better than people thought in terms of who has access to the internet, who has a smartphone, et cetera. And especially the younger end of the cohort of people living with HIV, they want everything on a mobile phone, right? They want smartphone access to all of the services that we can provide them. So we decided that the only way to make this, to even figure out what the intervention was going to be and make it really relevant to our cohort of patients is to make a patient-centered intervention by using visual participatory research methods. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we did to create this intervention. We had this idea that we already had a structure for delivering internet interventions that engaged people, that people actually used. If you could get them to start, they would persist with the interventions. None of them were focused on HIV at the time. And so we wanted to see what could we do with that structure and really make it highly relevant to this group of patients. And we thought about some of the comments we'd had during our formative work from patients living with HIV about how they didn't see role models. And so I'm gonna go back to the rural context for a moment. While I'm at the University of Virginia in the small city of Charlottesville, we serve 54 counties in Virginia, most of which are medically underserved, and our patients typically travel 2 to 2.5 hours for care. So that's the real world context of why they want this. And they say in their small towns and communities, they don't know anyone else who has HIV. Well, they must have known someone. But they think they don't know anyone. And no one is out about their HIV. And they're very isolated and they feel very stigmatized. We've heard horror stories of people revealing their HIV status even to a minister and being kicked out of a church, things like this. And this is current day. So they really want something that's private and accessible at home, and that makes them feel more a part of a community. So the reviewers at NIDA thought we wouldn't be able to do this, but I'm very proud to say that we did. We were able to get 10 patients from our own clinic, from a range of our settings, who came in and participated in this research and became our videotaped peer role models. So I'll tell you a little bit about how we did that, because I think it's an interesting story. So we approached first folks who had already applied for leadership positions in our clinic, such as to be a peer coach or a buddy. And so they already were showing at least some willingness to someone else, maybe with HIV, to be a little bit out about their status. And many of these patients were turned down as volunteers because they have felony histories. I don't really care. And so we reached out to them first, and then we also got recommendations from our clinic staff about people that they knew to be kind of eloquent speakers about their experience, even if they weren't sure if they would be willing to share. So we reached out to about 40 people, and from those 40 people, we asked them to come in just to talk with us about their experience, just two of us in a room with no observers, no video. So we got 10 to come in, and after speaking with them, each one told their story. We had a little interview guide, we had them tell their story, and we wanted to hear things about how they found out they had HIV, what their early experiences were in treatment, what stigma, if any, had they experienced, what addiction issues might they have had in their history, what mental health issues did they have in their history, what kinds of support were they getting currently, and how they were thriving living with HIV, because I've got to say, 201, these were folks who had, in some cases, really horrific histories, but they were thriving. So I really wanted all of them. I fell in love with these people. And all 10 said, yes, I will go on video, and I will tell my story again. I've got to say, this is some of the best work I feel like I've ever done in my life, and I'm very proud of it, and I'm very proud of them. So we conducted then sort of a run-through, a pre-production interview. We knew some of the parts of their stories. We tried to figure out, okay, how can we represent a range of stories in this intervention? And we developed interviews specific to each person based on what we already knew about them, and had sort of a pre-production run where they came into a studio and they saw what the setup was going to be, and they could get over their jitteriness a little bit and talk about their story again. And then about a week later, we had them come in with our videographer, who had already worked with us to develop a welcome to the clinic video, talking with patients about what it's like to come into our Ryan White clinic, introducing them to staff, and he's just a fantastic videographer. And so they told their stories for a third time, but this time on video. We then produced and edited and cut the videos down and had them come in to review all of the videotape that we were considering using for any purpose, whether for this intervention or for anything else. And each participant, although some of them were a little bit nervous, oh, I didn't know I sounded like that, or oh, I look a little heavy in that picture. they were really so generous, and every single one of them said, you can use this for anything you want as long as it will help another person living with HIV who was in my situation, every single one of them. So that's the backstory to this intervention. In the end, we decided we needed to celebrate these peer role models. And so we had like an Oscar party for them. So we brought them into our nicest facility. We literally got a red carpet and a little Oscar backdrop. We got little Oscar statuettes that said peer role model and their name. We did big catering for them, and they were very impressed with like crab dip and things like that. But we really wanted to thank and celebrate them. And so our whole team was there. A lot of our clinic members were there, and they got to meet each other. Many of them knew each other already because they tended to be people who were more part of the community advisory board, et cetera, in the clinic. But they were very grateful for that. And the last thing we did with our peers was we had short interviews with each one of them because I wanted to know what this experience was like for them. And did it have any kind of positive impact on them? And I was very surprised and pleased to hear every single one of them said, you know what, this has inspired me to do more. and several of the peers are now applying for advocacy positions at the national level, trying to work on getting messages out more, including one, Ramani, you'll be happy about this, who wants to be the Virginia women's advocate for HIV, living with HIV. Okay, that's the context. Now I'm gonna get into a little bit of the finer grain details. So we developed this intervention, Pause for Health, and I'm just gonna show you some static screenshots of this intervention, which is in now an ongoing pilot trial. Because we had to deliver our talks early, I wasn't able to bring all the augmenting video to show you an interaction, so I'll describe some of that as I go along. But everything about this intervention was co-designed with our peers. They were our beta testers. They did usability trials with us. We recruited some other patients to do this as well. So some of the look and feel might not be what I would have picked, but this is what they picked, and this is what appealed to them. So they came up with the title, Pause for Health, which stands for Peers Offering Support for Health. And they wanted icons of certain types. And so our instructional designer was able to come up with the icons for each of the cores. These internet interventions are sort of arranged like to mimic what we know about good evidence-based treatment in psychotherapy. And so we meter out a core week by week, because we've got a lot of information in each core, which is sort of like a chapter in a book or a psychotherapy session with psychoeducational material. And there are things for them to do with that material sort of between that and the next session. So we have the six cores, which includes social support, ART, using, which is the little one with the lightning bolt, goodness, I can barely see, depression, stigma and disclosure, and moving forward. So what they do, and I realize now this is really small for you guys to see, but they enter self-monitoring diaries. And the diaries are about ART adherence, about addictive behaviors, sort of what they've been using. We use sort of a timeline follow-back calendaring method. But they also enter daily diaries during the time that they're in the intervention. And they get behavioral charting based on what they're reporting as they go along. And they can look at this. Those who are assigned to this intervention can look at this whenever they want. Now, these are our fantastic peer role models. And so all throughout every core, the cores are structured in a similar way. So there will be some introductory pieces that are a little bit interactive. What are you going to learn here, and how are you going to do it? And what are your reflections on last time, last week, last session, last core? And interspersed throughout are peer videos. So there are videos that exemplify every point that we make sort of from the evidence base and the literature. At every point, we reiterate it by showing stories that the peers are telling about their own experiences, tips they have for the people who are using the intervention, et cetera. And there are opportunities for them to go a little more in depth with each peer so that they can take a peek. They might view the peer that they think seems most like them, or they may view all peers. And so far as we've looked at the usage as we've done the intervention, it looks like we have a mix of behaviors. Some folks are focusing on specific peers that, for whatever reason, we haven't found out yet why, but. And others review everything. They take in the entire thing. They want to see everything. So in the social support core, just a few examples. We have on the bottom here, you can click on each of these peers. It's the story of when they found out they were HIV positive. And fortunately for us, many of these peers have had HIV infection for a long time. And so they have that perspective of these epochs of HIV care, sort of what it was like at the beginning and, you know, they expected to die and all the things their family did to them and now sort of how they're living well with it. In the using core, we're using a lot of evidence-based substance abuse strategies to give them opportunities to do little short tutorials that are very interactive on strategies they can use to reduce their substance use. So it's very harm reduction oriented, uses a lot of motivational interviewing language in the way things are presented, and tries to be very patient-centered. Depression core is sort of the same. The basics of depression, the basics of how people get out of depression, and even some positive psychology evidence about things you can do that don't really look at tackling the depression directly, but it's more on building the strengths on the other side. One thing our peers and all of our patients have told us for years is that stigma and disclosure are still major issues in our population. And so we spent a lot of time on stigma and disclosure, made sure we got this well vetted by the patient population. And we give them a lot of activities that are very interactive. So when you're using this intervention, you click on things and things move and pop up and you get new education. We have this beautiful video sort of how HIV works in the body and then how ART works in the body that's very simplified and yet accurate in the ART core. And then we end with this positive wellness core that, again, borrows a lot from positive psychology, but everything we're doing is evidence-based. And fortunately, because we picked peers who are thriving living with HIV, they had all spoken about using these kind of strategies to live well with HIV, but without the lingo, right? They're just talking in natural language about what they're doing. And so we're able to have these gorgeous examples of what that sounds like in a person's language. So as I said, we did a lot of usability testing before we launched. And we found that this was understandable, that they liked the look and feel, that we made some changes based on their recommendations, and they rated the videos as the most positive aspect of this intervention, which does not surprise me at all. So just a moment about the trial. So we're still in this trial. It's a small pilot trial funded by NIDA. It's adults living with HIV and on an ART regimen, but they have to have missed a couple of doses in the past 90 days, and they have to have at least had risky drinking or drug use in the past 30 days. Now, I've got to say, and many of you in the room know, it's getting harder and harder to find those who are non-adherent, right? Luckily, you know, we're moving towards the 90-90-90 goals, and many people are adhering really well to their treatment, and the ones who aren't are not coming into the clinic for us to capture them there. So we're having to do a lot of proactive outreach into the community to try to find people. And what we've done, let me just show you our recruitment. Where is that? Well, I'm missing a slide. So for our recruitment, we are actually having the most success recruiting off of, believe it or not, Craigslist. Mm-hmm. So we put ads in Craigslist in not only Charlottesville, but around the United States in the volunteer section. And we're looking for people living with HIV that maybe are not coming to care, and that's how we're getting them. So here's our design. We have a pre-treatment questionnaire and diaries. We're doing a timeline follow-back phone screen to really make sure that they've had enough non-adherence and drug use or drinking. We're getting medical records to check our biological markers for care. They then spend about 9 weeks in their assigned condition, so it's either pause for health, the intervention I've shown you, or a patient education website that's just static. It's more like a WebMD kind of page that we've built. And then post-treatment, they'll repeat the same thing. So as I said, we don't have the data yet from this study. We're recruiting 80 participants, and we have 16 enrolled so far. We've gotten most of these from Craigslist, not even from our own clinic. And so let me just put this into context if it's efficacious. If this pilot looks good, the nice thing about any kind of technology-delivered intervention is you can be sure of its fidelity. You can test its active ingredients by, you know, adding or taking away components in a subsequent trial. You can deliver it to people at their convenience on a variety of devices. You can do responsive design so that something that looks great on a big screen can also look adequate on a little tiny screen on a mobile device. And so for those reasons, it's scalable. And this is what I think is the call for us for the future, is whatever interventions we have for the variety of issues that face people living with HIV or at risk for HIV, we have to keep scalability in mind. If not, then it's just you sort of, you know, spitting into the wind. We have to scale up our efficacious interventions and transform them into a delivery that the patients want, that people want, and that they will use. And so far, our usability and our usage data are looking really good. Those we do capture and get into the trial, which so far is not as many as we want, they are using it. And we are really eager to see what the impact might be. Thank you very much.
Right in front of me, Elvis trick in the book. Okay, well, the good thing about being on a history panel and going last is that you don't have to cover a whole lot of the details. And so even though I have some dense slides, I'm not gonna read or expect knowledge of all the details. For people who were here for the bio, I wasn't here at the beginning, although I'm not getting any younger. But I've worked in HIV from a number of different perspectives long enough. The inspiration for getting involved with this panel for me was I was on a detail to PEPFAR, and I shared a partition with somebody who was constructing a history of HIV. They were doing this for last year's international meeting. And they came up with literally hundreds of little vignettes. And I think they may have still edited them down a little bit for this, but if you go to hiv.gov, you can see this history. And listening to somebody construct this history, it's like, oh my God, I've really lived through a lot. I've known some of these people. It's actually in many respects kind of humbling because so much has happened and to be a part of it is really something remarkable. And what's interesting, like other people I've been reading this summer as well and going back, the place where people usually start with the history of HIV is the MMWR, the CDC weekly publication from June of 1981, reporting pneumocystis pneumonia in patients in Los Angeles. And so this stimulated the reporting on other cases of what came to be called GRID and AIDS, and now we think of as HIV. I'm going to be focusing probably more on research than anything else. And so in terms of research grants, I've been trying to figure out, well, when were the first NIH grants put out? And I think in terms of those that are relevant for us, two that are very important are the San Francisco Men's Health Study, which was one of a number of cohort studies. All of them were with men. Some of which came to be known as the MACS, which still exists, the multi-site AIDS cohort studies. And the San Francisco study is notable in part because it didn't continue into the MACS, it had a different design, but it was sentinel in terms of, usually it's the first citation of racial disparities in HIV. So this is something that has been there from the beginning. In terms of behavioral studies, what a former colleague of mine claims to be the very first behavioral AIDS study was something called a longitudinal psychosocial study of AIDS patients. And that was actually a companion to the San Francisco study. And the next study in terms of numbering in NIMH's system was another study that was attached to one of these other men's cohorts. So really, there has been behavioral work from the beginning. And even these cohort studies, they turn out to be probably some of the best data we have on particularly substance use in gay men, and have been used to demonstrate longitudinal patterns, including resilience over time. And these studies were later joined by IDU studies and the WISE, which in some respects is the women's companion to the MAX. And shortly after that, something called ADAMHA, which older people in the room may remember, was directed to fund programs to specifically look at psychological aspects of what was then called AIDS, and to work toward therapeutic and educational programs to respond to what were called identified needs. And shortly after that, we had the beginning of research centers being funded. And in terms of behavioral work, CAPS is probably the first example of that at UCSF. And actually, it predates the NIAID CIFAR centers, which focus more on biomedical approaches. And so, you know, as I mentioned, behavior was really important from the beginning and something that we probably forget for reasons that were probably shared by some of the people at APA at the time, that, you know, we think of this as a medical condition, and there initially actually was opposition to APA getting involved with HIV for that reason. But fairly early on, people recognized the importance of neuropsychological issues, particularly in the later stages of AIDS. And so NIMH organized a workshop on assessment, really focusing on both practice and research. And you know, a lot of the early interventions were very much homegrown. And so then there was an effort to bring together thinkers, almost all of them psychologists, to really come up with a conceptual perspective on behavior change. And this NIMH workshop that was done in 1991 was really sentinal for this. Okay, so I'm getting the hook, and so I'm actually, you know, I can be cue driven. So again, a lot of things were happening very early on and spurred on by psychologists. And if you go back to try to get a sense of how APA got involved, initially they didn't want to be, but there were psychologists in Congress. There were psychologists in the federal government. There were people, and also people at APA, who very much wanted the association to be involved. And so you had the evolution of a task force, a committee, and the beginning of program. You also had special issues of the American Psychologist, which are very instructive. I suggest looking at them. I think some people who wrote these articles would be a little bit embarrassed by some of the things that they said back then, but we all have those moments. But I think they're really interesting in terms of the issues that are still very much with us, like stigma, and issues that have gone away, you know, like hemophilia. I was surprised somebody brought it up because it's something that that I forget, and yet, you know, Ryan White, the inspiration for the CARE programs, was somebody with hemophilia. And, you know, back in those days, we sort of had to invent things. Even when I got involved with HIV in the 90s, we were still inventing things. And so we weren't trained as HIV people. We didn't have the kind of training programs that exist now, or the balkanization. Particularly, and so we came from a lot of different places and brought things good and bad with us. My background was in cancer. I'll skip through the middle years and all of the great accomplishments, many of which have already been discussed, but we're dealing with an epidemic that's rather different from where we started, but in many ways it's still similar. Most of the new cases in the United States are MSM. And gay men account for growing proportions of new cases internationally. We've seen progress in the United States with women, less progress overseas, and progress in terms of mother-to-child transmission. We here who live in D.C. were very excited several years ago when we finally had a year with no infants being born with HIV. That was, I think, really exciting for us. And new cases among injectors have been declining for many, many years. And so we've seen a lot of very complicated to do progress there. So we have lots of progress on biomedical modalities, but none of them has really become the magic bullet that we've expected. And for reasons that have been described in terms of behavioral issues for individuals, structural issues for people in general. And in terms of my current work, we've seen a lot of recent success in terms of doing more for substance users, although there is much more to be done. So where are we now? Okay, we have recent policy changes that have had big implications for research and practice. Test and start, the 90-90-90, which has been mentioned, so getting people on treatment immediately. CDC's high impact prevention, which emphasizes really the packaging of effective interventions, and NIH's changes in research priorities, which in many respects are a parallel to the high impact prevention. HIV work has become heavily internationalized. I spent 15 years mostly on, a little while off, working in Southeast Asia, and so I was really part of that trend. The educational messaging has gone from getting tested to now to thinking about viral suppression as a message. And we've probably had less emphasis on developing new interventions. We have a lot of behavioral interventions in the field, and probably a bigger role for program implementation, which I think has been a difficult transition for behavioral researchers. So there's been a lot of progress, much of it flavored biomedically, but there are still lots of old problems that are with us. Stigma, access to care, disparities, adherence, the issue of making behavioral treatments more durable over time, and frankly, the medical interventions are going to have trouble decaying over time unless we are able to help figure out how to address the behavioral aspects of these interventions. We've also had new opioid injection epidemics, although so far, other than the highly publicized outbreak that took place in Indiana, there hasn't been a lot of HIV in these. And we have some old problems with new recognition. So psychiatric disorder, which we heard about from Jean's presentation, non-injection substance use continues to be a contributor. Neurocognition, we don't have to deal so much with dementia anymore, but more subtle manifestations. Smoking, which is its own kind of interesting contributor that no one can really figure out. And the complexities of addressing youth. We've never really done a good job domestically or internationally. There are a lot of issues, many of them related to youth sexuality, that have made this very difficult to address. And there are some old psychological approaches that have new life, like behavioral economics, which anyone who went to Kahneman's talk, I think he did a very good job of deconstructing what that involves. But I guess the question for me is, where are the psychologists? Obviously, there are people in the room, but you know, those of us who've been in the field for a while are not getting any younger. And my impression from a number of different indicators, not a deep demographic study or anything, but looking at who's getting grants, who's on committees, who am I talking to when I do outreach into the community, particularly with aspiring investigators, is that there aren't really as many psychologists coming into this field. Fewer and fewer new investigators, the people in our pools, you know, we try to have different professions represented on review panels, but I'm still noticing that the pool seems to have fewer psychologists. One of the important historical things is that psychologists doing HIV work often have not been in arts and sciences psychology departments. Our centers that are headed by psychologists, typically in medical schools. And there was a lot of hostility toward HIV work even into the late 80s, early 90s in terms of people doing dissertations and other things. The other thing is that a lot of pioneers, you go back to the old American psychology, American psychologist issues and other places, and a lot of the people who are still active, and quite a few still are, have gone on to other things. And as somebody pointed out to me recently, there has always been an outsized number of people doing HIV work who were people like me, trained as clinical community psychologists. And that niche really has been filled by people from public health behavioral science programs, which is interesting in terms of just thinking about how a field changes. And some of it may be that a lot of people trained in community psychology or clinical community have wound up in schools of public health. Another thing that's curious is that suddenly there's a lot of interest in mental health again, including interest internationally, which never existed before. I can tell you that as a psychologist working internationally, there was rarely anyone else to work with. But a lot of the people who have this interest really have no training. I mean, I would be happy to see psychiatrists, social workers, you know, they don't have to be psychologists, but I'd be happier if I saw people with mental health training being the ones to show this interest, do the measurement, and be able to really move programs forward. The other thing is that, you know, you could do a whole presentation on the history of HIV and historical accidents. The involvement of APA fairly early on, you know, it had a lot to do with where psychologists were, both within the organization, within Congress, within the federal government, and it brought a lot of things together. And now everyone is really much more balkanized. There's, you know, some would say over-specialization in the field of psychology. Within HIV, there are people like me who have to really think about a lot of different populations, but most people focus on their own or on their own setting. So I think we really have to think about how do we connect psychologists to opportunity in HIV, particularly in terms of building the future workforce? How do we see our own value, and how do we break down some of these barriers? So let me stop here, and thank you very much.
So I'm going to do the speed round with you all because we are running short on time today. But I have to say, I mean, I could just drop the mic right here and say, boom, I'm done, because you all did such an amazing job summarizing 36 years of work in the history of the epidemic. And I thought it really, all the presentations encapsulated some really important milestones or thoughts about the work that we've done. I think, you know, starting with Eugene, I mean, I think you did a brilliant job kind of building these models and bringing models to your presentation that talk about how the history of the work we've done is reflecting where we are today. And that shows how much of the work in HIV and AIDS has really influenced the field more largely. And we see these concepts that were part of our work in the earlier days catching up to where the rest of the field is now. With Ramani, your mind is history, so important, incredibly important. Reminded us how stigma, racism, sexism influence the early response. You reminded us, too, that we have to think about who we're serving, what's important to them, their unique needs, and their issues. And Karen, I mean, I think you really represented kind of a transition in the work. We started to focus more on the needs of people living with HIV. We had effective treatments, so we could talk about what do people living with HIV need to do to stay healthy. And it kind of represents kind of this convergence of where we are in the field right now of technology, reducing the cost of interventions, and doing things that can be done at scale. In the beginning, that was a lesson we didn't fully understand. We built these interventions that required so much time and effort and so many sessions to deliver that we couldn't get them to the scale that they needed to be at. And then Rich provided kind of our history overview of everything, and I think really did a great job kind of emphasizing just how important behavioral scientists, psychologists were in the beginning. And I'm going to kind of jump off from that real quickly. So why was it that psychologists were so important in the beginning? And why was it that psychologists were allowed in? I mean, if you think back to the beginning of the epidemic, we didn't know a whole lot. We didn't have effective treatments. And quite frankly, a lot of the providers didn't want to have to deal with people with HIV. They're afraid of them. Our current Surgeon General told me a story about how when she started as a nurse, the food service person would put the tray down on the floor of the patient with HIV and kind of just push it in with their foot. The person couldn't get out of bed. No one would bring that tray to that person. She'd go and get the tray and take it to the person. And he was so grateful that someone showed him that little shred of human decency. So here's my theory. If you look at it, we didn't know a whole lot. We didn't have effective treatments, so we couldn't do a whole lot. People wanted to do something. So like, okay, psychologists, you do some stuff. You make the people who had this infection, who are probably gonna die, make them feel better. Deal with their mental health. Support them. There was so much fear and stigma too, that was something psychologists had to address. So much unknown were so important in developing the messages, the early behavioral interventions. Also, Ramani talked about this a little bit, the other. Quite frankly, physicians weren't equipped to deal with gay people. And if you think about the context at the time, and Rich talked a little bit about some of the studies that were funded. These are some of the first studies that were ever funded looking at gay and bisexual men. People didn't know how to talk about sex, talk about drugs, had thought they'd never met a gay person, and didn't know how to talk about all that stuff in their clinical encounter. So they welcomed psychologists into the room to deal with those issues. We adopted biopsychosocial because the medical piece was so bad. We built in all these other pieces because we needed to do something, and we used what we had. We used what we knew worked. Eugene talked about patient-centered. Our new Secretary of Health and Human Services is all about patient-centered. Why was it that patient-centered became so important in HIV? Again, we didn't have treatments that were effective. Physicians kind of realized, oh, I don't know what to do. Patients saying there's this alternative treatment and blah, blah, blah. And so they gave a little and it became more a back and forth interaction with patients. And the patients themselves, they knew they had nothing to lose. They were fighting for their lives. They were demanding to be heard. And they were demanding to get the help they needed. And it just changed so much in the dynamics between patient-provider interactions. I mean, it was just changed so, so much. Death. Another reason psychologists were so prominent was because, quite frankly, it's easy to forget just how many people were dying and how many people had the experience of losing multiple friends in a week or a month. So much has changed that it's easy to forget kind of the beginning and where we got. And it's also, I think, easy to bring with us the baggage that is left over from the way things played out. So for example, because we didn't have effective treatments, when we first started HIV testing, and that's actually how I got my start in 1985 as an HIV pretest post-test counselor. 85, when you told somebody they had HIV, you basically said, good luck. their support groups. You know, you should tell people that you got it, but we don't quite know really when you might have gotten it. Not really a whole lot we can do for you. Stay healthy, exercise, eat good food, get your rest, and go to support group. That was all we really had to offer. So post-test, in testing at that point in time, you were done. It was giving them the result, making sure they knew what the result meant, and it was done. And you didn't focus on prevention of transmission because they're gonna die, probably before too long. It's a little cruel to be telling them, you need to be responsible, you can't do this, you need to do that, when you're dealing with somebody who is looking at a not too far away death at that time. So we didn't build in those systems. Because we didn't have effective treatment, it didn't really matter if people were linked to care. When treatment became more effective, it wasn't recommended for everybody. It was for people at a certain CD4 count, as Rich was saying. So we didn't build in these systems to link people to care immediately, even when we had better treatment, because it might be years before they needed to be in treatment. And we didn't understand the prevention effect of treatment. And I think that's the most fundamental change that we're facing now. I've been in this work since 85, and there have been times when I've just been, quite frankly, depressed that I'd retire and this epidemic would never be over. Now, however, I feel we really do have the tools, we have the knowledge, that if we use them and take them to scale, we really can bring an end to HIV. We now know that effective HIV treatment that suppresses people's viral load leads to, in the studies that have been done so far, we don't have a single case of HIV transmission that's linked to someone who's virally suppressed. With treatment, as Karen mentioned, I think, people can live a normal lifespan if they're diagnosed early and stand care. But if you think about how fundamental prevention and care have changed now. These aren't one-time things. When someone's diagnosed, it's a lifetime of being in care, taking your medication, and maintaining a suppressed viral load. So we're now building whole new systems where we're trying to figure out, with surveillance systems that were built really just to figure out where somebody was diagnosed, count how many people were diagnosed, and then to find out when they died, to find out how do we keep track of people for a lifetime, and how do you build these relationships with people. We know that now only about half of people living with HIV in the US are in care. We're about 400,000, between 400,000 and 500,000 more people who need to be in care who are not currently. Too often, I think, we only recognize the challenges of individuals in staying in care and adhering to care. And they're real. They're important issues. They have to be addressed. So mental health, transportation, all the things that are sort of person-centered or about the person's context. But we're not paying enough attention to what is it about the provider that makes people not want to go back? What is it about how we structure the system of care that makes it so difficult for people to make an appointment, to get back into care? And why don't we make it the clinician's responsibility or that clinic's responsibility to maintain that relationship with the patient over time? Really, if you don't come back for your visit, your doctor's done. You are not counted in the statistics for that provider or that program. You're just not in care, and you drop out of the denominator. So I think we are now at this time of incredible promise, but it's also a time where, quite frankly, we've lost some of the passion, some of the attention that used to be on HIV. Not there any longer. And in part because of the great progress we've made. But despite that progress, we still have 1.1 million people living with HIV in this country. We still have about 37,000 new HIV infections that occur each year. And we still have 12,000 people living with HIV who die in the most recent year that we have data for. So this is still a major public health problem. It's one that we have the knowledge and the tools to beat. But I think the question is really going to be, are we going to commit the political will, the social will, and the resources that are going to be necessary in order to end HIV? So I'm going to leave you with that. And I think there are lots of roles for psychologists and all of that. But I want to thank you for your time and for being able to be a part of this amazing panel. So thank you so much.